The main protagonist of first season of War of the Visions is coming out. He's the Earth Selection Unit, so everybody's going to be able to get him and get all the shards to MLB him for free. Granted, they can beat the quest, which is a whole different challenge. Now, Camillo is a really strong unit, and he was handed out with the Light Selection quest. I honestly believe Miraga is even stronger. He's actually a beast of a unit. I've seen some footage in JP where he single-handedly carries team. So today we'll take a look at his kit, his stats, his abilities, how to build him, and just generally whether he's worth the blossoms for you or not. So first of all, he's got a move 3 jump 1, but can change that into move 4 jump 2 because he's a ninja. He uses axes just like Vikings, but unlike Vikings, he actually uses armors. Outside of that, helms and accessories. So typical heavy armor guy. He has the Earth Master ability, so increases HP and Earth attack for everybody on your team, and then his own attack is up. His TMR, I think, is one of the best axes in the game. The whole reason for that is the 25 initial AP up. That is very competitive with a lot of other stuff. 25 is basically as much as you start with when you're a physical attacker, so it pretty much doubles your starting AP, meaning when you reach the enemy team, you have one more powerful ability you can use. If you're running an axe user paired with another character and you want that other guy to have bells, well, at least you have some way of throwing out your strong abilities. So I would definitely go and build him to 99, just for the axe if you're a fan of Yurma or you're planning for eventually, maybe, we'll get Summer Kilfe. In terms of his own role in a team, Miraga is a bruiser. He's mainly a physical bruiser, but he can take some magic punishment as well. And then he has something that's a little bit similar to the Black Rose Helena, which is that his damage is really hard to mitigate for a long time. He has the ability to break barrier, he can give himself defense penetration, just a little bit, but at least it's something, and then he can also give himself slash resistance penetration. So he has ways to ignore every kind of damage mitigation in the game. And then he can also grant himself human killer, you know, just for PvP usage. So overall, he's a very reliable damage dealer with very bulky stats. So talking about stats, we'll compare him with Yuar Zazan and Dwayne, because they're both slash-oriented bruisers, so I feel like they're the right characters to compare to Miraga. In terms of HP, Miraga is right in the middle, so he will have quite a few. I've seen Yuar Zazan reach like 6, 6.5k, and Dwayne 7 to 8,000, so he'll be within that middle range. He has 608 attack, which is the highest among these guys, but he doesn't really have an attack increasing passive, so I would expect him to have similar to what Dwayne has when he goes into a fight. Luck, that's good, that's average, he's not going to be extremely accurate from that. And then he has 62 agility, which is the same again as EX Dwayne. That is not the top tier speed, but it is fast enough to actually act and fight, so it's competitive. Then 8 defense, super good. He will be able to stack defense very high, as we'll see in the builds in a minute. Then in terms of resistances, he's got good slash resist and strike resist. The slash part might be very impactful, but is slightly weak to magic. He has a couple abilities that scale of faith in his status effects. I recommend not raising your faith very high, because coupled with the magic weakness, he's going to get destroyed by magic if you raise his faith too much. Then he has resistances to slow, a little bit to immobilize, but mainly to disable, which is really good, because you know, when you're disabled, you don't do anything in War of the Visions. So it's one of those status effects that are very impactful in combat. Now, here's some really good news. He gets most of his stats at 115, and his 120 ability, I think, is not that great for him. So if you can't clear all the quests, and all you manage to get are the Mind Spheres to 115 the guy, he's still worth building. And then cherry on top, that only costs you 3 blossoms instead of 6. So what you're missing out is like a little bit less than 300 HP, a little bit less than 60 attack, but let's be honest, when you have 600 base attack, 60 isn't that impactful. So overall, I think you can afford to just take him to 115 and he'll still do a really good job. So let's look at his passives first. He's got one that increases his HP and decreases evasion. It feels weak to me. I would probably use a combination of the other ones. Increased defense and HP would stay there all the time. And then if I need extra mobility, if it's a long map and I want to reach the enemy gunners, for example, or for manual play, I would run Shikuchi for the extra move and jump. If I don't need that, I would run the Ninja Lore, whatever that is, for extra agility and luck. Luck will make you more accurate, and then agility just makes you fast. So overall, really good passives. Then counter abilities. Let me say, the chance to counter Even though it's a really high chance from his main job that increases your attack is weak. 30% of his base attack is going to be 200 attack. While that is strong, I don't think it's going to win you the match altogether. You don't need that extra 200 attack more than stay alive. Paladin Guard has 20% chance to shield you for 45% of an incoming physical attack. To me, that feels like the best thing. If Nuragaz stays on the field for one more attack that he does, it's going to be way better than just having 200 more attack in his kit. And then Poison Barb, well, it's a lot weaker than the other options in my opinion. Now, looking at his main job. So, first move. Line, Barrier Break. That's already super cool. Then his first buff is going to increase his defense by 25 and his spirit by 15. Remember when I said he was a bruiser? That is the whole reason why. He increases both his resistances to damage and then also increases his defense penetration for 3 turns, so he gets some way of an offensive buff. But that does decrease his healing power by 20. What that means is not only will he heal others for less, right? But he will also be healed less if he's targeted by a heal by anyone else on the field. And that will also affect how much HP he gains back if he uses some of his HP drain ability, because as we'll see later, he does have some of those. So while it's a very good buff, you have to be careful about if you want to set it on or off, or if you want to use it in manual, because it comes with a cost. Then Devil cancels ability activation and decreases magic, which is super cool, but it's short range, so I don't know how often you'll be close enough to the mage to actually cancel what they do. Then he has his long range attack that increases human killer. I think this is his bread and butter. He goes closer to the enemy team. In his first attack, before he actually gets in melee range, he's gonna increase his human killer, and then he'll use one of his strongest moves to finish off the enemy. It's what I've seen a lot, and it really works out well. His next attack is shorter range, quick breaking the Snake King break. Thank you, Google Translate. But that ability increases his own slash resistance penetration, deals heavy damage, and then has a chance to slow. I think that's overall really cool, especially once you EX it and it only costs you 22 AP. It's not that high of a cost for a very powerful attack, but of course you have to be in melee range, so you won't get the chance to use that all the way very often. His 120 ability is his only piercing attack, so it's one of his AoE options. That's good, but honestly, 165 mod isn't that great, and the stun chance, he won't have a high faith, so that will probably only be 25 to 35%. I don't know how necessary it is. Of course, I would leave it on if you get him to 120, but don't consider that he's not playable unless he gets his 120 ability. I think he does just fine with his other stuff. Then if we look at the sub-job, well, he's got another one of these abilities with a cost, right? He consumes 15% of his own HP and gets 100 debuff resistance. That means no debuff can apply. You cannot decrease his dark resistance, you cannot decrease his defense, you cannot decrease his attack. Like, no matter what stat you're trying to decrease on this guy, what debuff you're trying to apply, it won't work if you use this buff. But here's the issue. You have 25% chance to just suicide yourself by triggering Berserk on yourself. So maybe if you find some way to give him Berserk resistance, that could work, because then he won't be susceptible to it. But otherwise, that move will most likely cost you the game if it procs. So it's kinda dumb. I would never use it unless I have ways to go around that. And then his other move is an AoE Absorb HP. That sounds super cool. If you can land it on a couple people, you'll just end up being full HP, which is very interesting. But here's the thing, he has some really good other sub-jobs, so I don't know how often I would run that, especially considering that his main buff that makes him bulky decreases his healing power. So here we walk into the first powerful job, which is Paladin, right? Blade Bash, large damage, low AP cost, chance to stun. Saintly Heal, never use that. Sentinel, I don't know. I feel like I want him to use his other buffs, which are really good. But then Tunning Blade, right? He does not have a cross-shape AoE attack in his main job, so he needs that if he wants to hit in an AoE. Just for that reason, I think Paladin's job sub is good. It also has a super long range, and since he's bulky, giving him some hate isn't that bad. He'll just take the heat away from your other guys. Divine Grace, not terrible, but not the best buff. I would usually turn that off. And then, well, Immortal Spirit, right? We all know how strong Courage is, and right now, there's still just one unit in the game that can dispel Courage, which is Sakura, who doesn't have her EX job and nobody uses, so not a big issue. Ninja sub job, I don't know how often I would use that. The main reason why I still think it has value, though, is the passive for mobility that he gains from it. And then if you need some accuracy, if you're running him in manual setups and you feel like if you're going to fight an evasion team, you need one way to fight them, well, Ninja Sub Job provides you with the Decider of Fate with accuracy up 60 for one turn, so you can land that one powerful hit. And then just for raids in general, Dream Within a Dream, 3-hit Earth slash Chain. That's going to be very useful in a couple scenarios. So let's look at his Bruiser build with the very thematic name, Mont. What he has is a little bit under 7,000 HP, but 51 defense and 18 spirit before his buffs. So if he uses his defensive buff, his defense goes up to 76, and then his spirit goes a little bit over 30. Overall, those are really good stats for somebody who's going to be in the front line. He has enough mobility to be the first one that the enemy team targets, so that's good. And then he has over 1,000 attacks, so when he does reach the enemy team, he's going to hit super hard. And reminder, when I show these builds, I don't have any other party member vision cards, so you could get his attack much higher or give him some other kind of buffs if you wanted to. What I like about this is just that he hits hard, tanks a couple hits, and moves quickly. What else would you want out of a damage dealer, right? He's going to be a great partner with other characters that leverage Earth power, so Luelle, increasing Earth attack in an AoE, would be a really good partner for him. She also targets the same kind of teams, which are physical teams. Eileen or Winter Venera, if you have them, have the ability to decrease Earth resistance, so then Urega comes in and just deals even higher damage. Otherwise, well, anybody that reduces slash resist is going to be a good partner for him because everything he does is slash attacks. So because of that, I would pair him with somebody like King Mont, right? Who's going to gather hate and take a couple hits. He's going to decrease the enemy team's slash resistance. And then when he finally goes down and the enemy team's low on AP, they're never going to be able to kill Muraga because he just has that much defense to keep tanking for a couple more turns. Of course, the Barbarian King does have a couple weaknesses. I would avoid fighting to B. He's not that accurate, so he'll struggle with hitting her in the first place. And then, well, she ignores defense, deals piercing attacks and slashing that are wind element. So, you know, she has a bunch of advantages over Nuraga. Then Black Witch Helena can decrease his spirit. His spirit is the main reason why he can survive a couple hits from mages, because he does have a magic weakness. So she's probably going to kill him in 2 to 3 hits, which is scary for your damage dealer. And then another character like Enemy Luelle would be a really huge threat. She can ignore spirit up to 80 if she has the right passives and buffs, and then, well, she can use magic attacks to blow him to bits. So depending who you fight, you should still be careful. He is a bruiser, but not against every character in the game. So here's my verdict. This guy is a serious badass. I've seen JV footage of him kicking ass, and I think everybody should consider getting him to 99 for some Earth quests and whatnot, and then probably eventually to 115. But don't rush, since we have a lot of stuff coming, and if you're short on Blossoms, he should not be your top priority, unless, again, you plan on using him right now. I think you should just slowly farm the shards, slowly start leveling his resonance, and when you need him, EX him, use him, he's gonna be great. For PvE, not the most necessary character. Obviously, you generally want mages and characters with high initial AP because you can't use bells on all your physical attackers. So generally, physical characters are rated a little bit lower in this game mode for me. Then for Arena, if there is an era for Cloud when Final Fantasy VII hits, this guy is going to shine really well because he's going to kick Cloud's butt. He basically has the element advantage and can be built for very good slash resistance, which is going to work wonders against Cloud. In general, for any of those lightning teams, you want to fight enemy Frederica's, bring him in, he'll do a good job. And enemy Ninas, same thing. So there are quite a few characters that are kind of Eternals of Arena, you see them once in a while, and against these guys, he's gonna shine. For guild battle though, not the character I would use, because you don't know when you'll run into one of these sneaky Tabis or eventually sneaky Tifas and whatnot. So there's a bit of a risk here. Also, whenever an enemy team has mages, he's going to struggle a lot more, and he doesn't really have ways to recover. In fact, he decreases his own healing power, so he's going to be very strong for battle 1, but I'm expecting him to be dead for battle 2 or very low early in the fight, so he might die very quickly in the second one. I think he'll shine in manual PvP because of how wide variety of a move he has, right? He moves quick, hits hard, can break barrier, can inflict powerful debuffs on the enemy team. So he could definitely do well, especially in a season like the one we have right now, where there's a ton of gunners. Yeah, he would just walk up to Frederica and kill her, so that there's some pretty good potential here. Auto PvP, well, just a little bit less. Again, it's the same thing as for guild battles. Since you're going in blind most of the time, you don't know who you'll be fighting, and I'm expecting Black Witch Helena to just hex him from afar and he'll die. So, depending on the matchup, might not be the best character to use. So overall, is he a new Dwayne? Is he a new King Mont? I don't think so. I think he's just a little bit below these guys, but still a really good character to use, especially considering you don't have to invest any viz into him. You just need to invest the blossoms and materials. So for that price, he's really strong. My plan is to not build him just yet, though, because I only have one blossom right now. So we're gonna have to wait to see him in action. So that was it, guys. Thank you so much for watching, as usual. I really appreciate all the comments you give. If you have any feedback, ways to improve on those videos, let me know, and then see you next time.